Good morning and welcome to our Sunday service here at First Baptist Church of Kittanning, our service for Sunday, May 17th. We're so glad you could join us wherever you may be. Again, we're thankful that we are able to reach out to you wherever you are. So tell your friends. We're on Facebook and YouTube, and hopefully in the not too distant future, we'll be able to get back together in person. We are thankful that our area has moved into the yellow phase here in Pennsylvania, so we are allowed to start small gatherings, and with that, our Board of Deacons and Deaconesses will be meeting this Tuesday at 7 here in the sanctuary, and we're going to start talking about how we can do things a little differently when we come back so that everyone can be safe. So we are making plans, and we want to send thanks out to ABCOPAD, our region, the American Baptist Churches of Pennsylvania and Delaware, for all the information that they've been providing to us. It's been a big help. And our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 61, verses 1 through 4. Hear my cry, O God, listen to my prayer. From the ends of the earth I call to you. I call as my heart grows faint. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. For you have been my refuge, a strong tower against the foe. I long to dwell in your tent forever and take refuge in the shelter of your wings. Now let us worship the Lord in song.
Hail him, hail him.
Well, hello again, and we're glad that we can sing together. You might be getting some strange looks around wherever you are if you're singing out loud, but we hope that you are. Today, we do have a guest speaker with us. We want to welcome him, Jeremy Andrews. We've had him before, and we're glad to have him today, even in these slightly different situation than normal, but he is dean at the Biblical Life Institute, and I will be hearing from him shortly, and thank you very much for being here with us. And that is because Pastor Mark and Jan are on vacation, so we want to keep them in our prayers as well. And also, I just wanted to let everyone know that as we at some point transition back into live in-person worship here, we hope to be able to stream our services live. And to do that, we're probably going to need a little more help up in our audio-video booth. So if anyone out there is interested in that, or possibly interested in that, you know, pray about that, think about that, and let us know if you're interested. And we'd be glad to have some more help up there. So let us go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this time that we can come together in worship wherever we are. Lord, we thank you for the technology that makes that possible. We thank you for those gathered here in this house, your house, and we look forward to the day when we can all worship together here together. But Lord, we know that you are present with us wherever we may be, wherever we are gathered in your name, whether it is on a screen or here in person. Lord, we want to pray for all those who have been affected by this COVID-19 pandemic, those who are worried and have issues with jobs and finances, with health, those who are suffering from loneliness and isolation. Lord, we ask you, the great physician, to grant health and healing to those that need it, to give your comfort, your strength, and your presence to those who are alone. Lord, we ask for you to guide our decisions about reopening, both here in our church and in our state, in our nation, and around the world. Lord, we just ask you to give us knowledge and the information that we need. We ask you to guide us and our leaders. Lord, we pray for Pastor Mark and Jan on their vacation, that you may be with them and refresh them and fill them with your love and your comfort and your spirit. Lord, we pray for those that are having health issues that are maybe unrelated to this pandemic, but are still out there, still real, still painful and worrisome. Lord, we pray for those that are dealing with cancer, whether themselves or a loved one, for those that are in pain, those dealing with addiction. Lord, we know that you are the great healer, the great physician. Lord, we know that you love us so much that you sent your son, Jesus, to die on the cross for us, that our sins may be forgiven. Lord, we just ask that you will fill us all with your power and your Holy Spirit. We ask these things in the name of your son, Jesus, who taught his disciples to pray in these words, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen."
We are moment, you are forever. Good morning, and thank you all for having me here this morning. It's an honor and a privilege to be able to be sharing in the Word with you this morning. As Jamie said earlier, my name's Jeremy, and I'm the dean at Biblical Life Institute. And it's always an encouragement, it's always a blessing to be able to be sharing the Word. And having been able to be here a few times, I have just really appreciated this church and the reception that you all have given to me. So I'm deeply thankful, deeply grateful for the opportunity to be able to share in the Word with you all this morning. But before we dig into God's Word, I'd like to open up with a word of prayer. Would you pray with me? Holy Spirit, Lord, we invite you to open your Word to us this morning. Open our eyes, our ears, our hearts, and our minds to what you have for us. Teach us. Convict us. Let us know if there's an area of our lives that is unpleasing to you. Remind us of your unfailing love. We thank you for the gift of your Word. We thank you for what it can teach us and how it can shape us. May your Word pour deep into our core. And may it work to make us more like Jesus Christ. We pray all this in Christ's name. Amen. Early on in my ministry, I was working at a small rural church that was made up of folks mostly in their 50s and above. They lived in a really tight-knit community. It's the kind of place where everyone saw your comings and your goings. There wasn't much that you couldn't hide from your neighbors because everyone saw everything that was going on. Despite the fact that there was a relatively tight-knit community, they would often share about how they were saddened by the cultural shift with their physical neighbors away from this sense of building community towards isolationism. They didn't phrase it that way, but instead they lamented the lack of what they called neighboring. Those folks were frustrated at the fact that they rarely saw kids outside playing. They were noticing that front porches were going unused as gathering places. They saw folks pull out of their driveways before the sun rose and pull back in after the sun set. The neighbors would then go into their homes for the rest of the evening. They grieved that backyards were well manicured, but rarely used for playing or for barbecues or for socializing. They noticed that patios had just enough chairs for families, but not for visitors. Backyards might have pools, but were rarely, if ever, used with neighbors. They had a hard time with the fact that people were almost never invited into the homes of others for conversations. And those conversations that did happen, or that do happen, oftentimes revolve a little bit more around gossip than they are genuine conversations aimed at getting to know one another. They noticed that there was very little space for hospitality. Instead, people's schedules were full. Time was spent outside of the neighborhood, and people used their homes primarily as a means of rest between jumping from activity to activity. And I have to admit, as I get older, the more I understand what those folks in that neighborhood and in that community were referring to, what they were lamenting, the sadness they were feeling over that shift. The idea of neighboring resonated and continues to resonate with me today. But in our modern context, it can be difficult to discern the best way forward. Sometimes we aren't particularly good at identifying who our neighbor is, and We're even worse at intentionally engaging our neighbor. There are all kinds of excuses that we come up with. We're too busy. I have to run here. I have to take my kid there. There's always an excuse. But the truth is, our priorities don't usually allow us to neighbor very well. If we really believed it was important, we would prioritize it and we'd make it happen. If this problem resonates with you as it does with me, or if you find that maybe you have some people in your life that could use a good neighbor, the first question I think we have to ask ourselves and reflect upon is this: how am I contributing to the problem? And then we ask and reflect upon, how does God want to use me to reach other people in my sphere of influence, in my life, in my neighborhood? And with those two questions in mind, how do we learn to better relate to one another? How do we learn to neighbor well, particularly in a time when our traditional modes of engagement are hampered by things like wearing masks and social distancing? How do we learn to intentionally create moments of true connection between ourselves and others? How do we learn to identify our neighbor or truly see them as our neighbor and love them well? Jesus tells a parable that will help us, I think, better understand how to do these things. In the parable, he confronts prejudices and subverts expectations. He highlights that loving our neighbor will require sacrifice. And he shows us that mercy needs to be the norm, not the exception, as we engage with others. And so we look at Luke chapter 10, verses 25 through 37. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "What is written in the law?" he replied. "How do you read it?" He answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." "You have answered correctly," Jesus replied. "Do this and you will live." But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" In reply, Jesus said, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. 'Look after him,' he said, 'and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have.' Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" The expert in the law replied, "The one who had mercy on him." Jesus told him, "Go and do likewise." The first thing I think we need to understand as we look at this parable is that Jesus was approached by an expert in the law who meant to test him. He was not actually seeking to learn, nor was he coming with kindly intent. His goal was to test Jesus, to trip him up, and hopefully to make Jesus look silly. He began an inquiry around the topic of inheriting eternal life. Jesus responded to him in verse 27 by saying, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. The expert in the law then latched on to Jesus' use of the word neighbor. As an expert in the law, the man was very familiar with a passage in Leviticus 19 that stated, "You shall not take vengeance, nor bear any grudge against the sons of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." Again, Leviticus 19, 18. There was an interpretation of that passage that existed that suggested that the verse was only applicable to other Jews, particularly because there's further passages in Leviticus that outline the appropriate behavior towards foreigners. But the question seems to be meant in part to test Jesus' knowledge of the law and how Jesus understood his relationship to non-Jews. And the expert in the law seemed to perhaps have an interpretation that suggested that only other Jews were his neighbor. But instead of giving him a direct answer, Jesus tells him a story that challenges the expert and confronts him with his prejudices. He tells the story of a man going down from Jerusalem to Jericho on the road that was known to be very dangerous. The man finds himself in an encounter with robbers, and he was left for dead on the side of the road. Jesus then highlights a priest and a Levite, two men that the expert in the law would have a great deal of respect for. The priest and the Levite pass by the man, two potential heroes of the story. The very Jewish men not only walk past the man, they actually go out of their way to get as far away from him as possible as they pass him by. Now, we don't know exactly why they made that decision, why they passed by him on the other side of the road. Perhaps it was because they were worried about being unclean, but whatever the reason, they passed him by nonetheless. Then Jesus subverts expectations, and he takes the story in another direction, probably an offensive direction to the expert in the law. Jesus said that a Samaritan came along, dressed the man's wounds, took him to an inn, and paid for his care. For our law expert, this would have been a very hard thing to hear. In Jesus' time, Samaritans were considered to be at the bottom of the social rung. Throughout the Gospels, we see Jesus criticized by religious leaders for hanging out with tax collectors and sinners. That would have been a hard pill for those leaders to follow. However, to many, Samaritans would have been considered lowlier than even the tax collectors and the sinners. They weren't just outsiders or foreigners. The hatred between the two groups was intense and fierce. After Solomon's reign as king, his successor, Rehoboam, made a number of pretty grave decisions and mistakes with his economic policies, which caused a serious divide between the northern kingdoms and the southern kingdoms, the northern tribes and the southern tribes, which led to an inevitable divide between the nation of Israel, between the northern kingdom called Israel and the southern king called Judah. Animosity grew between the two groups over things like idol worship and mixed marriages. Both sides argued for religious superiority, and this eventually leads to the point where Jews refused to have anything to do with Samaritans. And so for Jesus to tell a story with a Samaritan as the centerpiece, as the hero, someone who was that low on the totem pole, would have been an affront and would have been scandalous to the expert in the law. So much so that if we take notice at the end of the story, the expert's response to Jesus when he asked who the neighbor was, the Samaritan as the hero of the story was such an affront to his sensibilities that he couldn't even bring himself to say the Samaritan. He simply said it was the one who showed mercy. So what does this parable have to do with us learning how to neighbor well? Well, number one, Jesus teaches us the need to overcome our prejudices and our biases against others. If we want to love our neighbor, it means that we need to redefine who our neighbor is. It will require us to ask hard questions about ourselves. Questions like, what are my prejudices? What are my biases? What are the things that keep me from loving my neighbors? To keep me from living with and loving those who God has called me to engage with? If you have anger or hatred in your heart because of where a person comes from, or because of the color of their skin, then you're not living out a kingdom-minded, Jesus-centric ethic. If we pursue Jesus, he's going to reveal those things about us. He's going to confront us with our sin. He's going to confront us with our prejudices, just like he did with the law expert. He will confront us with our hard-heartedness and transform our hearts so they become more loving and open. The love of Christ should break down the barriers between people, not build them. More directly, this means that our neighbor is the drug addict, the alcoholic, the adulterer, the refugee, the disabled, the gay person, those of us with a different ethnicity or skin color. Our neighbor is the poor person, the rich person. And in today's overly politicized context, the Republican or the Democrat, whoever sitting on the other side of the political spectrum from you is also your neighbor. The only right way to define our neighbor is whether or not they are human beings created in the image of God. Since every person falls into this category, we have a responsibility to love them well. There is no barrier that stands between anyone and their need for Jesus, and their need to be loved by us. By telling this story, Jesus reminds us that our neighbor truly is everybody. Secondly, this parable helps us to understand that loving our neighbor is going to take time and resources to accomplish. In a word, it's going to take us sacrifice. We don't love our neighbor by ignoring them, as much as I wish that was true sometimes. The priest and the Levite that passed by the man in the ditch sacrificed nothing but a few steps to get to the other side of the road as they passed him by. They ignored him. The Samaritan man sacrificed his time by stopping, tending wounds, and making sure he was cared for after the fact. He sacrificed resources by using bandages and valuable oil and wine. He used his donkey to aid in transport and used his money to aid in care. This means that if we intend to neighbor well, it will be at the sacrifice of our time, of our money, and resources that may be precious to us. It may mean that we put aside our own wants and desires. The Samaritan was clearly on the road going somewhere, somewhere that he probably needed to be. He delayed it out of love and concern for the one in need. I don't know about you, but oftentimes I lament interruptions, especially if I'm focused on a particular task. I don't like to be interrupted, but I have found that those are often the moments that God has called us to be attentive and intentional with our love. It's in the interruptions that ministry frequently happens. Are we willing to make those kinds of sacrifices for those who may need us? for those who might need to experience the love of God, for those who might need the love of a good neighbor. And thirdly, this parable reminds us that mercy really needs to be our default setting. Kindness, compassion, forgiveness, they need to be our modes of operation. And I get that those things can be difficult, that they can be hard from time to time. I also get that it could and should probably take us some time to get to the place where we show mercy, especially when we've been traumatically wounded by others. But in general, as believers and as followers of Jesus, mercy needs to be our calling card. Jesus commanded the law expert to do what the Samaritan did, namely, to show mercy to others. And so this morning, I would encourage you, as you contemplate the story of the Good Samaritan, as you think about how you relate to the neighbors, whether they be physical neighbors or people in your life, search your heart for prejudices and biases that may prevent you from loving your neighbor well. Ask God to show them to you and to help you deal with them. Make some time to focus on helping one person this week and to show them love and mercy. If you're uncertain who to invest some time in, pray that God would reveal somebody in your life, that he would bring somebody into your life that could use a kind word, a helping hand, perhaps a loving smile, or who perhaps may be lying near death in a ditch in need of someone to stop and care for them. When we identify those things that keep us from neighboring well and move to change them through the work of the Holy Spirit, we become more like Jesus. When we love our neighbor well, we are becoming more like Jesus, but we are also actively engaging others with the gospel. And we're working towards bringing God's kingdom to bear in their lives. May we seek to love our neighbor. May we seek to neighbor well. When things open back up for us again, may we think to have gatherings on our front porches and in our patios and our backyards. May our neighborhoods be full of kids playing. May we seek to have conversations with others that build up, that encourage, that challenge us to be better. May our homes be more than a place of rest between activities. May our homes be a place of hospitality. May they be a place where we invite others into safety and security. May our homes be a place where love is shown, where compassion is given, where empathy takes place, and where the love of Christ reigns. May we think differently about how we steward our time, about how we steward our possessions, about how we steward our homes and our families. Again, may we seek to love our neighbor, to neighbor well, and to see God's kingdom come to fruition in the lives of others. Would you pray with me? Lord, we come to you this morning acknowledging that we don't always neighbor well. Sometimes we get busy, we get wrapped up in our own stuff, and we fail to see the needs of others around us. And we admit that sometimes we see the needs and we pass by, just like the priest and the Levite. Lord, we ask you to help us to be like the Samaritan, You would help us to sacrifice, to see needs, and then to help find ways to meet them. Lord, align our hearts with yours that we might love, that we might engage, that we might seek to build your kingdom. We might toil together in community to see wholeness, to see thriving, to see your kingdom come. We pray all of these things in and through the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.